be kind of practical presentation after Alex's theoretical presentation. I'm Michael Istria. I work for Red Hat in Alex's team on Eclipse IDE at large, from platform to language server support, including build stuff and so on. And I'm going to tell you, to show you, and by the way, explain you how we made Wild Web Developer, what components we're reusing, and what value it provides in Eclipse IDE. So this is the Wild Web Developer website, where there is a description of everything. But before we get into details of Wild Web Developer, let's think a few years back of how Eclipse was for web development 3-4 years ago. So there was the legacy JavaScript development tools, which were totally outdated and mostly of bad quality. The HTML and CSS were not supporting the latest release. It was really bad, and I think Eclipse lost some users over the years for various reasons, and I think this reason can count for 1 million of users because the web tools were bad. But Eclipse is still a very relevant IDE for many ecosystems because it's free, open source, polyglot, versatile, multi-platform, multi-project, scalable, extensible, with built-in Git support, good comparison tool, local history, good search feature, a lot of edition commands, and a huge and serious ecosystem. So, yeah. So for all these reasons, we could not just let Eclipse be bad at web development, which is now 60% of the market of development. And we said, okay, we need something better. It was the rise of language server. We'll use language servers to do so. And that's how Wild Web Developer emerged and provided a lot of feature for web development that I'm going to demonstrate and go into details. So let's get started. This is a good old Eclipse IDE with an old-fashioned light theme that everyone can read in the room. And we start by opening a CSS file. So I open the CSS file, okay. This is a CSS file. It's not the old CSS file. It's only Wild Web Developer. The syntax highlighting is coming from TextMate. And you'll see that it has some edition features like documentation, color preview. Here there is the outline. If I make a mistake here on purpose, it will show an error. The error is shown in the usual views, the outline, navigation. And the color preview, yeah. Color preview as a color picker, that's one of the things I like to demonstrate because it's just nice. It's not very important, but it's nice. And so we have all that for CSS, and this is not something we implemented. We just picked the VS Code CSS language server. There are people at Microsoft who did a good job regarding CSS. We just take their job, take their work, and reuse it just like they're reusing the Java compiler of Eclipse IDE. So this is for CSS. Another popular format is JSON. This is a JSON file. So if I put crappy JSON like this, it will fail because it's not conformed to the JSON grammar. Okay, same thing, error reporting, outline, and so on. And since JSON has schema in a strange way, but it has schema support, here I describe the schema. So we have the documentation, we have content assist. How can I have content assist like this? So if I, what may be a Boolean here, module type, well, I can do that. True, and it should run because it's wrong typing. I can format. So we have, it breaks the highlighting, but it's not a big deal. So we have a lot of features coming also for JSON, and this is, just like CSS, the VS Code JSON language server that provides all that smartness. Integrating the JSON language server is exactly the same thing as integrating the CSS language server, instead that we start a different script to do the magic, but there is no difference in the consumer code. So we have the schema completion, and if I open a popular file name like tsconfig, everyone knows the tsconfig, the schema is built-in. So you don't have to declare the schema, the IDE declares, the language server already knows some schemas that are popular, so you don't have to add schema on popular file like JSON or ESLint, like tsconfig or ESLint. Okay, that's CSS and JSON. I also have YAML, but I need to save time. That's the official reason. The non-official is that I have a bug with YAML in my demo. But. But we have XML. So the YAML support, when it's working and when I demo it, it's actually a Red Hat-based language server done by some colleagues that we are using. Just like we use the CSS component from VS Code, we are using the YAML component from Red Hat, from NPM.js, and just everything we do. More importantly, the good old XML, we have a language server for XML. Alex mentioned it. It's currently on GitHub on some repository, but it's going to be the Eclipse Lemmings project next week, and then it will be officially a vendor neutral Eclipse project. And what it does is that you get typical grammar, XML grammar checks. So it's plain XML meta grammar check. So this is invalid XML. It reports invalid XML. And it has schema support for documentation or compilation or everything. So you get a full-featured XML grammar language server. And soon we'll have the extension for Maven, for example. So we'll add into this smartness some things that can give the value of distribution ID in your context and so on. That's really near future. So we have formatting, outline, blah, blah. Okay, that's for XML. Now let's get to the funnier languages. Well, my favorite, I would say, for this demo is the HTML one. So we have an HTML file, which I open with a web browser, and I reopen it with the editor. Okay, I put the web browser here because it makes a nice demo. No, yeah, thanks. I'll enable auto-refresh. So we have the web browser, the code editor with the outline and so on. I can break HTML with some bad stuff. Well, how to make bad stuff in HTML? Oh yeah, I wanted to show completion first. So we have completion for HTML elements, as usual, with documentation. This is coming from the HTML language server from VS Code. We get completion, we get automatically closing tabs. So if I put A and open a tag, next is slash A. We get control click on href and things like that, so we can navigate to the resources. And also, yes, that's about all for the basics. And if I change the text, the cool thing I wanted to show is that with this navigator, okay, I did something wrong in the style. I broke my CSS. So with this embedded navigator and the auto refresh, we get a very fast feedback loop when editing XML. So we have a fast edition thanks to language server, and we have a very fast feedback loop with the auto refresh in the web, in the internal navigator. We have support for inline CSS. So here I have a bit of CSS in my HTML file. We get the same CSS support than we have on plain CSS file because it's actually using the same language server under the hood. So the VS Code HTML language server will invoke the VS Code CSS language server to get the CSS assistance that you're seeing here. It's the same one as VS Code because it's the same engine. Always keep that in mind, that it's the same engine, it's the same result. And so with this fun thing, I can just change the color with my super color picker and save, and we get the color updated. We have also embedded JavaScript support. So if I'm here, there is a button on click which say hello. If I control click on it, it will find the say hello declaration in the HTML file. That's a feature provided by the language server. And in this JavaScript file, we get some assistance. So here, if I hover on the variable I, it says it's a number. If I change it to be a string and hover again, it becomes a string. So the ID reacts properly to JavaScript change. We get completion, we get content assist, and all that. So. Oh yeah, one I can show is if I'm in a variable and select it, I can do find references, which is a typical Eclipse operation. Find references is usual. And if I hit enter, it didn't find the references. What did I do wrong? Okay, I show it with the plain JS file, but it's strange. Very strange. Sorry, I am too curious to search. Okay, it didn't work, but it works in real life. That's totally intended. So you've seen there is support for JavaScript, but not all JavaScript are not all web projects are front end. You can have JavaScript services. So there is the hello.js file, and we have support for plain JavaScript, similarly to everything I show you. So I won't go into detail. Control click. Assistance. Maybe here I can try find references. I'm taking risk, as you can see. Whoa. Okay, something went mad. Sorry about that. Okay, I'm back. You can enjoy the very fast startup that Lars mentioned earlier today. Fuck. I'm meeting the wrong shortcut. That's something I opened the bug, but it. Sorry. Okay, Control 3 is better. Find references. Okay, find references doesn't work, but there is a rename. Okay, and you change the variable to new name, and the variable change. So we have the find references that you saw working very well, and the rename as well. So that's all the typical feature you will need for JavaScript. And this same language server that we are using, that is actually the TIA JavaScript TypeScript language server. Eclipse TIA is one IDE developed in the Eclipse ecosystem by some folks, which is more targeted to be embeddable in a web browser. As part of this IDE, they have developed a language server for JavaScript and TypeScript that we are using here. And here it's TypeScript, so we get the same thing for TypeScript. Rename. And so on. So you got a regular flow. There is format completion. That's all. The cool thing with the TypeScript language server is that it uses TypeScript TS server under the hood. So if you open some project that have ESLint enabled, they will support ESLint. So they reuse the configuration of your project directly. So here you have ESLint commands because the tab is not necessary here. So that's one cool thing of the TypeScript language server, is that it's extensible, just like TypeScript itself is extensible. And another one I can show you is the Angular one. So the Angular language server is done by the Google Angular team. So we are picking the language server. And we have a component, the JS. We can click on the HTML, and we see some completion. So there is field and title, and I can control click to get back to the TypeScript file. If I add a fosdem equal lol like this, and get back to my HTML template, fosdem is there, and it says it's a property and so on. So here again, very good development flow. If I put a property that doesn't exist, I get a validation marker. We tend to forget that the markers are more important than the completion in real life, but you always get that. So that's very cool. We have got a very strong tool suite for development in Eclipse IDE for low cost, because we just picked pieces from other projects. But developing is one activity of a developer. I mean, coding, editing, it's one activity. And I would even argue it's not the one that takes the most time and the most smartness. The other one is debugging. Debugging is a very important activity. Actually, when you are used to your debugger, you constantly have a debugger on and you're editing the code you're debugging. At least in Eclipse IDE, that's how, since we get the constant refresh, I almost always have the target application starting and edit it and get the hot reload of the class and so on. So the debugger is really my favorite tool, and I guess I'm not the only one. So if I get back to this hello.js file, we have support for debuggers thanks to the debug adapter protocol, which is a kind of friend of the language server protocol. It's also used by VS Code. It's also debugger agnostic, language agnostic, everything agnostic. So we could embed it just like the language server protocol. And for the plain.js file, we have the node debugger, which is the debug adapter coming from VS Code, the same one. And we can debug in a file just like we do usually in Java. So we have the breakpoint, the call stack on the left, navigable call stack, step-by-step navigation, variable view, and editions, and so on. So, and the play, next. And the variable didn't change because let's try again. I probably mistyped something. Okay. So the value did change at the runtime as expected. So this is a simple debugger, nothing fancy. It just works, does the job not for a cheap price, because it's Microsoft team who did that. And last but not least, the HTML file. This HTML file is dynamic, there is JavaScript and so on. So we can do the same thing, except that instead of debugging directly with Node, we can debug with one of the browser which has an embeddable debugger. So I'll use Chrome for the demo. Do I have the shortcut here? Chrome debug? No. Debug as Chrome debug. And Chrome is started. It says, OK, it found the first breakpoint. Same thing. It's actually the same. If you look in the details of the language server, it's the same debugger for Node and for Chrome. Because when you debug Node in VS Code, it actually starts the V8 from inside Chromium to do the stuff. So it's the same thing. You get the same features. That's normal. And we can change the value. We can make it a string or a student, and JavaScript doesn't really mind. And we get that. And here I have my web page. If I click on Say Hello, we see that even the inline inline.js is there. So I can do the same thing. I is a string. Let's say it's Hey, for them. Okay. F6, we can inspect the document also, by the way. So where is the document? That's the beauty with JavaScript. Go find something in all this context. Well, okay, you see it, yeah. Maybe I can hover on it and get details. Yeah, too bad the size is not perfect, but... Well, anyway. Who needs that? So there is a small glitch, and you see the message has changed. Hello, hey, for them, and just like in the Chrome debugger, the button has changed as well. So I'm done with my demos, and I'd have a few words to repeat what Alex said, because you are in a brainwashing session about LSP and debug adapter, so you have to hear the same thing over and over again. So the usage of language server protocol and debug adapter protocol has allowed us as a small team at Red Hat leveraging LSP4J, LSP4E, and so on, which are major components. But once we have all that, it took us less than a year to get from scratch to this, if you count a full-time employees. It's even a matter of months. It's a project we've been two or three working on one day a week or something like that for 2 years. I think so, yeah, probably. So the return of investment of using language server in Eclipse IDE is for us as developer. It's extremely high because it didn't cost a thing, almost. It's really cheap. And the value for user is very high because the language server are of high quality. And for that, we can thank Microsoft for shipping those language servers, and Microsoft and Red Hat and other, everyone who do language server. And one cool thing is that while doing this work, we have identified bugs in language server that we've reported. The HTML support in VS Code, for example, is now slightly better because of a bug I reported 6 months ago that got fixed. And when VS Code makes a new release with a new CSS support, an incredible new tag, we get it for free. So we've got this factorization, it's not even a technological factorization. We are really talking of a domain community factorization. And the mindset has changed. The collaboration between IDEs is getting much better, as Alex said. And that's really, yeah, a good thing for the domain. And the list of language server keeps growing, the list of linters keeps growing, and we can just integrate them with a few lines of Java in Wild Web Developer, so it's really productive. Everything is open source under Eclipse Public License or MIT License. And that's my last word. And I take questions. Any question? Yeah. So that's the duty of the, we are the tool providers. Wild Web Developer is a tool. It's the duty of Wild Web Developer to ship the language servers, unless for this language there is a better way to do things. But here the language servers are embedded. The node packages that do the magic are inside the IDE. You don't have to install them. Yes. Yes.
And the second one is starting, stopping, supervising the language server process. Is that something you just spawn a new process and then you are done, or is there some more?
It's really stupid, and that's what makes it work great. You start the process, you communicate with the process. When you don't need it, you stop it. I mean, the tool stop it. You as a user, it's not your problem. I mean. If the process is remaining when everything is closed and is taking you some RAM, you open a bug to the provider saying, hey, man, you have to stop your process here. What's the deal?
I think this topic also relates to the next session.
Yeah, we can go on because in the next session, Jan will demo the LSP support in NetBeans and NetBeans-related LSP stuff, and we'll have time for questions after that. So maybe with one more demo, you'll get more questions or more answers.
So this